So we have been anxiously waiting for this fateful day, the very first episode of Tokyo Ghoul Re. Now, I just got done watching the episode, and for the most part, I actually have a lot of good things to say about it. But before I get started, I do want to mention one thing. I know a lot of people want me to reflect back to the manga and use the manga as a reference source. For the most part, I could do this, and I could sit here all day completely critiquing and analyzing and picking apart the episode and the anime in general, and overall comparing it to the manga, right? But for me, that is not an enjoyable experience, and I don't think it's going to be an enjoyable experience for you guys. I'm not going to pick it apart. I'm going to treat the Tokyo Ghoul Re anime like any other anime. I'm not going to even talk about the manga whatsoever and how it produces and holds itself up on its own terms. So, the first thing I want to talk about is the story that they cover in the first episode. So, we get introduced to an abundance of different characters. Obviously, Hayase Sazaki, Matsuki, Yuri, Shirazu, not Seiko just yet, Akira, and Chihori, just to name a few. And we also get a little bit of development for each of those characters. I kind of liked how they split up the episode. Considering Hayase is the main character, we have a lot more focus on Yuri and Shirazu as they are investigating a ghoul known as Torso, who is getting in a lot of incidents, and they're trying to track him down and obviously neutralize him. So the focus on Yuri and Shirazu is a pretty big thing because we get kind of the idea he's like as a character. And straight off the bat, you know he doesn't work well with a group. And Shirazu is one of those like easygoing characters, if you will. You know, he's got like a goofy side to him. He's the goofiest out of the entire Quink squad as we get introduced to them throughout the episode. Yuri's kind of like the hard ass one, you know what I mean? He never really smiles. He's just blank expression, but he has a very big motive behind him. You know, he wants to excel past his own limitations. He wants to excel past Hayase, his leader, if you will. And he wants to kind of achieve the best results by himself, which is definitely a good way that they've pictured Yuri, because you get this straight off the bat, and it's a good way to understand Yuri's character for the most part, because this evidently has a lot more emphasis in the future. Now, as they progress through the story, we slowly get a bit more interaction between Matsuki and Hayase, and they're kind of bond with one another, which at this point, you've kind of got Matsuki and Hayase working together against Shirazu and Yuri, because they're kind of like, they want to do their own thing, and Yuri even himself is kind of manipulating Shirazu and being like, you know, you need this money. And the only way you can do that is by kind of getting all these achievements by yourself and not with Hayase, not allowing Hayase to get this achievement as a squad or just get that achievement for himself. You need it and I need it. So we got to do our best to compete and not work as a squad, which kind of defeats the whole purpose, obviously, of the QS squad, the Quink squad. But ultimately that all comes around in the future and it helps kind of showcase the characters a lot more, which I think they've done a pretty decent job of doing straight off the bat. At this point, we don't see Seiko, we see Kaneki and Matsuki kind of go against Yuri and Shirazu, looking for Torso as well. And we're kind of flying through the episode at this point. We're seeing a couple of different characters. We meet Donato for the first time, which was pretty cool. Not all too much there. A little bit of Chihori, however the fuck you pronounce her name, who is obviously supplying information to Yuri and Shirazu. And then they kind of go on to look for Torso. They go and hunt him down with the information they have. And at this point, you kind of have Matsuki by herself. And this is kind of her little bit of, episode time. And she picks up on Torso. She gets in the taxi ahead of this other chick. And then kind of like this whole fight breaks loose. You see a little bit of Matsuki, but then you also see a good portion of Torso instead and how kind of deranged he is. So the portion of Torso I found was pretty interesting as well. The way they depicted him kind of came off very deranged and tormented, obviously, which I felt like was a really cool thing. You know, he was stressing out. He was freaking out. He's like, what the fuck? I don't have my mask here today. How do I deal with this situation? You know, all these people are coming after me. And he takes off basically with a half-beaten Matsuki in the backseat because Matsuki's struggling at this point to even produce a Kagane out of her body. So she's kind of using these little hand knife things, which, you know, she's pretty prolific with, but obviously not to the extent of Torso. From here, Yuri and Shirazu are chasing after this taxi. They enter a roadblock and then all hell kind of breaks loose. Shirazu and Yuri fight off with Torso. And then another character appears known as Orochi. Now, obviously I know who this character is, but keeping it spoiler free, I'm not going to mention it. And he comes in and basically obliterates everyone on the battlefield. He obliterates Yuri, Shirazu, Matsuki, even flooring everyone. And it kind of seems hopeless at this point, even to the aspect of Yuri biting on his own arm to try and get his own Kagane out. You know, they're running out of time. There's only so much they can basically use their Kagane to an extent. And they used a pretty good portion of it throughout the episode. And when they get to this kind of prolific character that is extremely powerful, standing right in front of them, they can't ultimately do anything until Hayase comes in and basically saves the day, goes toe to toe with Orochi, and then Hayase and Kaneki talking to Hayase in his head, asking him to use him and bring him out and everything along the sorts. You see Orochi kind of like, you know, who is this? This seems familiar to a certain degree. To end off the episode very nicely, we have the infamous finger cracking from Kaneki or Hayase. We have the reveal of Hayase's Kagane protruding out of his back, and that completely ends off the episode. Story-wise, it was rather enjoyable. The one thing I guess I picked up on straight away was the music. They really love their piano work in this episode. It's kind of the whole thing that carries it. Literally the first minute and a half before the intro is like filled with piano work, and then even after, and it's just littered throughout the whole episode, which I'm not complaining about because I actually found that piano very fitting for the episode, if you will. Very fitting for the story because it's not like just some mellowed out piano work. It's very obscure and just destructive, and it sounds real twisted, and it's just like chords that aren't meant to be playing are playing. Everything's all over the place, and it kind of sounds like a clusterfuck at first, but it has a bit of control there. That's kind of like the perfect depiction of Hayase at that point. So I really enjoyed the piano. The fact that they switched it up as well, it wasn't just the same continuous loop of music throughout the episode, was really nice. I did notice that they used the section from, was it the live action trailer? Or there was a trailer that they released a while back, which was like a dark undertone. I don't know how you would describe it, but they kept using that throughout the episode in like really weird places, I guess. Like the whole Donato situation, they started using it, and it was kind of like this weird dark undertoneness. It's very subtle, 3 episodes, so I guess it doesn't really matter, but you can tell it because it's the same thing over and over again, and they really kind of just reuse it. So they had a bit of metal at the end of the episode, which I thought was a nice touch to kind of finish off everything. Considering it was the big fight scene between Hayase and Orochi and whatnot, they kind of kick it off with this metal song, and, you know, I thought it was pretty well done for the most part. I do have some cons. You know, I've been talking about some stuff that I enjoyed about it. I also enjoyed the art style for the most part. I was very iffy when we seen the trailer, but after seeing how it was produced and implemented into the episode, and, you know, all in one piece, you know, wasn't too bad. Thus, it was the first episode, and we'll see how the animation and the quality of the character designs kind of follow through the entire season. I'm hoping it doesn't drop, but you never know at this point. I found the character designs rather enjoyable. There was a lot of color in them, and they had a lot of, I guess, darkness, but emphasis on the Kaganes as well. Like Orochi's, for example, it was like fully black always, or like a gray, but then it had like this pulsing sparkle electricity, whatever you want to call it, of like color, like a rainbow-esque, but like, you know, it just had a color pop through it. It'd be like kind of like a pulsating thing. I kind of like that for the most part. It's not the overall depiction of what a Kagane looks like, but for how they're kind of producing it for the anime variant, considering its predecessors, I think this is a much better way to go about it. A lot of people may think it's dull, and for the most part, I can agree, but I do like when they kind of had that pulsy flash of colors kind of come through. It kind of makes it seem like it's electricity or something, but that was at least for Orochi's case. Everyone else's were pretty stock standard for the most part. They were like solid objects, except for Kaneki's, which came out all fucking rainbow, colorful-esque, so that was really cool to see. I want to see how that's implemented into a fight, though, because I think that's the biggest con I have, is the fight scenes were very goofy. You know, some of them were not too bad, but it was very cut and split all over the place. Weird to figure out what was going on. It was kind of just like, oh, you know, they're clashing with each other, and the Kagane comes out, and they'll do like these zoom shots, and they're like, it's all just kind of like misplaced, and there's no real flow through the fighting, at least in my opinion. I feel like it was a little bit messy, especially when you have such dark backgrounds, and you have like these really, you know, vibrant character colors. It's like, whoa, 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 and just all flashing all over the place, and then you're trying to see the Kaganes, and it gets pretty wild. I also found the Yuri kind of self-talking a little bit goofy. I understand it's a prolific thing for his character, and I'm glad they're even doing it, but I think the way they implemented it kind of just felt goofy for me. I just laughed every single time he was kind of talking to himself, which I would say get used to it because he does it a lot. It's kind of like the main trait for his character. I just thought the way they kind of implemented in like a very close-up slide of his face, and it was all kind of colored over or something, and then he's just like, you know, him speaking, I was like, okay, in a dialogue, I get it. I think that's basically it. I rather enjoyed this episode. I didn't think I would for a lot of different reasons. I thought I'd have a lot more issues with it, but because I'm looking at it from a certain perspective, I think a lot of people will really enjoy this episode. The animation quality dipped here and there. The music was repetitive to a certain degree, but also pretty nice. Character designs pretty fluent and looking pretty nice, at least in my opinion. So we'll see how that holds up in the future. But overall, I rather enjoyed the episode. I'm very excited to see where they progress from here. You know, how technical do they truly get? You know, there were some pretty good moments in there. I did actually really enjoy the mini Yuri flashback to when he was a little child. I thought that was pretty well done with the music they had behind it, and obviously the Kaneki and Hayase ISA situation, so I'm interested. Obviously, way too early to say how well this whole season's going to do, but so far, I enjoyed the first episode of Tokyo Ghoul Re. So with that being said, let me know what you think. Did you like the episode? Did you hate it? What's some of your favorite parts from it? What's some of the biggest things you hate from it? With that being said, I'm actually going to end the video off here. Hope you guys enjoyed. Don't forget to subscribe. I greatly appreciate it. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.